Your Bible with me to Acts 7:44, and let me read just a couple of scriptures. Acts 7:44. Who can read for me, brother? Brother Bright, can you also read for me in Isaiah 66:1-2? Acts 7:44, our fathers had the tabernacle of witness in the wilderness, as he had appointed, speaking unto Moses, that he should make it according to the fashion that he had seen, which also our fathers that came after brought in with Joshua into the possession. And your Bible, it probably says Jesus, which is the same name for Joshua and Jesus are the same name. And the possession of the nations whom God drove out before the face of our fathers unto the days of David, who found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. But Solomon built him a house. Yes. Nevertheless, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet, heaven is my throne, earth is my footstool.
That's it.
What house will you build me, said the Lord, or what is the place of my rest? Brother, there are two questions here in Isaiah and in Acts 7. The two questions that I was basically going to preach a little while on today, but I'm going to preach a short time on today, are these questions: where is the house you will build me? Ask God. And the second question is, where is the place of my rest? Ask God.
Yes, yes.
The reason why so many people struggle in walking the Christian life and getting where they need to be with God is because they hadn't learned the difference between what is religious and what is salvation.
Uh-huh.
They are trying to build a house for God. They are trying to do the right things for God. They have a desire and a sincerity to live for God with all their heart. But they're struggling with their walk in God. And it's because of the fact that they're still got that old idea that most people have, that if I can just get good, I can get God. Well, let me tell you something. You don't get good to get God. You get God to get good. Amen. Amen. You see, David wanted to build a house for God.
That's right.
David said, I dwell in a house of cedars. My God dwells in a tent. So I want to build a house for God. I have a desire to see a monument for God. I have a desire to see a temple for God. I have a desire to have a place where we can all come together and worship God. I have a desire to give to Israel and to Judah a place where they can come and meet with the Lord. I have a desire to come to a place where we can offer those sacrifices of the blood of the bulls and goats, and the priests can go into the holy place like they did in the tabernacle, and they can have the brazen laver, and they can have the altar. I have a desire to do all these things for God because I'm sincere. I want to live for God.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Jesus.
But God said, David, you are not going to build me a house.
That's right.
You hadn't quite got it just right yet, and you're thinking.
Yes.
You don't really quite understand what
the Spirit is all about.
Amen. You don't quite understand what relationship with me is all about. I don't care about the house you want to build. As a matter of fact, David, I want you to know something. Because you're a man of blood, I'm not going to let you build the house. But in order to honor what you desire to do, I'm going to let your son build it. I'm going to honor your desire. Let me tell you something right now. I don't believe all Christians are saved.
All right now. Thank you, Jesus.
I don't believe that everybody who goes to church is saved.
All right. That's right.
I don't believe that on this Sunday morning, when you have thousands and millions of people attending the house of God somewhere, that they really know what salvation is all about. They've learned what religion is all about.
Yes.
They've learned what going to church is all about.
Yes.
They learned what Sunday school is about. Some of them have good preachers, even though they don't preach the truth.
That's right.
Some of them preach as much truth as they know, and they do a fine job about it.
Right.
You know, I had a man in our church out in Pennsylvania. He didn't even have the Holy Ghost yet. And normally I wouldn't let a guy behind my pulpit didn't have a Holy Ghost. But you see, I told him one day, I said, you know, you love the Lord with what you know. You've been baptized in Jesus' name. You've been living for God the best you know how. I said, kind of remind me of a guy named Apollos. I said, the Bible said Apollos was fervent in the Spirit, knowing only the baptism of John. He didn't have the Holy Ghost. Amen. But he had a revelation about who Jesus was. He hadn't been baptized yet in the Holy Ghost. But the Bible said he was fervent in the Spirit. And he knew the baptism of John. And he went out and he preached Christ with as much as he knew. And so God was using that man even though he didn't have the truth. But still, he only had just a little bit about what he needed. Aquila and Priscilla had to come along and show him the way of God more perfectly. You got to have more than religion. You got to have more than a church. You got to have more than a building. You got to have more than all the Scripture. You got to have more than knowing exactly what you need to do. You got to have something down on the inside. Because God is not interested in the house that you build for Him. God is not interested in how religious you're going to be.
That's right.
Yes, Lord.
Amen.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
But He will honor your trying. He will honor your desire. He will honor the young man that doesn't have the Holy Ghost, but he wants to live for God. He will honor the young lady that doesn't have the Holy Ghost, but she's made a commitment to stay faithful to what's right and what's wrong and what's true. She will honor the young person that behaves themselves and tries to witness for Jesus the best they know how. But even so, I'm going to tell you something. Even though you have all the right intention, the Lord said, except the man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. Unless the man is born again of the water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. No matter how much you pray, no matter how much you worship, no matter how much you shout, no matter how much you try, no matter how much you love to live for God, no matter how much you love going to church, you gotta have the Holy Ghost. Some folks compromise it. But you see, they hadn't got the message. The message was question number one. What house do you think you're going to build for me? Solomon was sincere. I got to share this just this little bit with you. Because this is so amazing to me. Solomon, like David, wanted to build a house for God. He was sincere about wanting to be able to worship the Lord and have Israel worship and have Judah worship and offer the sacrifices and do the things that are right. Just like so many are today.
Jesus.
He wanted to build a house for God.
My Lord.
As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us that Solomon that David had gathered all the gold and gathered all the materials and gathered all the stones and gathered all the stuff he needed to build the house of God. And then Solomon, it says over here in 2 Chronicles that Solomon hired himself 80,000 woodcutters and 70,000 stonecutters and 3,850 foremen. Amen. And he got them all together and he began to build. And for 7 long years, they built the house of God.
My Jesus.
You know what was so amazing about that? That house to me, it was so beautiful that here we read in 2 Chronicles 3 verse 8, it says that the porch that was in front of the house, the length of it was, according to the breadth of the house, 20 cubits. That is 30 feet wide, 30 feet long, 30 feet high. And he overlaid that whole porch with pure gold.
Yes.
Amen. Inside the holy place, he put up all the walls and he overlaid them with gold.
Yes.
He laid down the floors and he overlaid it with gold. Amen. He built this temple according to 1925. Listen to this. The Society of Illinois, I had to share this with you. The Society of Architects in 1925 in Illinois, they did a study about how costly Solomon's temple was. In 1925 money, Solomon's temple was worth $87 billion. The cost of the temple, according to Ballot-Purvis, the talents of gold, silver, and brass used in the construction were valued at $34,399,110,000. The vessels of gold, according to Josephus, was valued at 140,000 talents, which equals a sum of $1,876,481,515. Amen. The priest's vestments and robes worth $10,050,000. The trumpets were worth $1,000,000. Solomon had 10,000 men cutting cedar, 70,000 bearers of burden, 80,000 hewers of stone, 3,800 foremen, and he paid them all 7 years their wages, $33 million worth. He bought their food. He paid them bonuses. All that estimated around $344,385,440. The gold and the silver and the jewels on the rest of the stuff was estimated at $12 million.
Glory to God.
He overlaid he overlaid the walls with gold.
Yes.
He overlaid the floor with gold.
Yes.
Amen. He put in all that stuff he did. All of that for a place where God visited and never lived.
My Lord.
Thank you.
All that.
That's right.
For a place that God said, I don't care about that. I come visit your church.
Yes.
I come visit that little temple you do give me. I come visit you in your moment of religion.
Yes.
I come check in on you once in a while when you're in your sincerity trying to live for me. But that's not what I want. Answer my question, where's the place of my rest? Amen. That rest, he said, is on the inside of you. I want the Holy Ghost inside of you. I want to be your rest. Amen. With stammering lips and another tongue shall he speak to his people. And this is the rest wherewith he called the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. Amen. He said the Holy Ghost is not here. The kingdom of God is not here and there. But the kingdom of God is inside of you. Amen. The Bible said on the great day of the feast, amen, Jesus stood and cried, if any man thirst, let him come unto me. Whosoever believeth in me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. That's the same key of the Holy Ghost, that they that believe on him shall be saved. On the day of Pentecost, the Bible said, they were all gathered together in one place, in one accord. And he said there came a sound from heaven, as a rushing mighty wind, and fell on the house where they were sitting. And there appeared in them 12 tongues, like the fire set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues. The Spirit of God gave them. What house you going to build? Just how religious can you get to get me on the inside?